My God is big, so strong. Hey! Well, greetings. I'm Pastor Milton Wren Jr.
And I'm Lady Angela Wren.
And you have tuned in to the Kingdom Experience. We are excited that you decided to tune in today. I want you to do something. If you want to connect with us, simply text KBB to 54244. That's KBB to 54244. At Kingdom Builders, we have about four or five ways you can give, but let me give you a few of them. They'll be on the screen. You can give through Cash App. You can give through Givelify. Or you can give through Text to Give, which is one of my favorites, and that is by texting KBMG to 54244.
And listen, don't build alone. Text, tag, and share this live with someone. Start your own watch party, but don't build alone.
I want to say this. They say hearts is the new hallelujah and thumbs up is the new amen. So I want you to go ahead and practice. Come on, take your time. Practice. Let's go ahead. Give me some thumbs up. Give me some hearts. Let me know that you're tuned in now. We want to connect with you even during the worship as well as the word. We want to communicate with you. And we're getting ready for something that we really love at Kingdom Builders, and that is our family fellowship time. We believe that everybody deserves at least 8 hugs a day. So we're getting ready to hug. I can't wait to hug you, and I'm looking forward to it. Can we do that now?
Well, babe, we can.
We can.
But they can't.
They can't.
We have to practice social distancing.
That's right. So can we cyber hug? That's one thing we can do. So let's go ahead and cyber hug. Let's get 8 hugs together. You ready? I'll start us off. 1. Let's go. Number 1, I need you hugging. Come on. 1. All right. Would you lead us at number 2?
Hug number 2.
All right, number 3. I see somebody you're not hugging. You're still looking at me. I need you to hug. Come on, number 3. Number 3. That's it. That's it.
And hug number 4 really big. Let's go.
All right. All right. Come on. Put the coffee down. Put the Pepsi down. Ready? Number 5. Number 5.
Hug number 6.
Number 7. Number 7. Number 7. I need you hugging. That's right. Come on.
And really big hug number 8. Let's do it together.
Yes.
Ooh, hold it.
Yes. Ooh. Yes. Listen, thank you so much. I feel better now that I've gotten a hug from you. We're getting ready to go right into worship and then the word. Someone's coming to lead us in prayer. I hope you're ready because I believe this word is going to change your life. Let's get ready to build. We'll see you later.
You come.
here on this evening to give you your Wednesday in the Word. That's right. We've been in this two-part series talking about you can't quit. And I want to just share this quick word with you. I believe it's going to bless you. It's entitled, You Are Not Out of Options. Let me say it again. You are not out of option. In 2 Kings chapter 7, verse number 8 through 11. Listen at this. 2 Kings 7, verse 8 through 11. It says, and it'll be on the screen for you. And when these lepers came to the edge of the camp, they went into a tent and ate and drank. And they carried off silver, gold, and clothing and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried off things from it and went and hid them. Verse number 9, it says, Then they said to one another, We are not doing right. This day is a day of good news. And if we are silent and wait until the morning, punishment will come upon us. Now, therefore, come, let us go and tell the king's household. That's critical because the king is the one that put them out of the city. Verse number 10, so they came and called all the gatekeepers of the city and told them, We came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, no one was there. No one was seen, no one heard. Nothing but horses tied and donkeys tied and tents tied as they were. Then the gatekeepers called out, and it was told to them within the king's household. I want to talk for a few moments with this thought in our mind. You are not out of options. Come on, say that with me. You are not. Come on, say, I am not out of options. I believe it's a trick of the enemy to make us feel like we don't have options. You have to quit. You have to play the hand that life has dealt you. But I'm reminded of a story about a preacher that went on this lavish vacation in the middle of the jungle between South Africa and between the coast of Costa Rica and Panama. It was a remote, secluded island. Listen at this. After 22 hours of flying, he took a taxi from the airport, which took another 4 hours to get to his destination. After about 2 hours, he got frustrated and asked the cab driver, When are we going to get there? To which the cab driver replied, Relax. We have 2 more hours to go. Think about this. He was more upset at the time because he was already thinking about the 4-hour drive back. After getting there, he met a couple from Minnesota, and he asked them, How did you all handle that 4-hour ride? To their surprise, they looked at one another and they smiled. They said, Well, what do you mean 4-hour ride? It only took us 45 minutes. He says, How? He says, When you landed at the airport, did they not tell you that you could charter a flight and get here in 45 minutes? He said to himself, I wasted a lot of time, energy, getting frustrated because I thought I was out of options. Can I say this to us? That's where the enemy wants us. He wants you and I to feel like we don't have any other options. We have to deal the hand or play the hand that life has dealt us. But I want to say this to us, that the power of life and death is in our tongue. How do you know that, Pastor Ren? You have the authority to speak over your future. You have the power to speak over your life, over your children's life, over your finances, over your body. I know this because an open mouth, here it is, always opens options. This is your kingdom nugget. Write it down. An open mouth always opens options. In this particular text, matter of fact, before I get there, I want to give you about 20 seconds. I think that's a good place. Let me give you 20 seconds. Speak some things over your life. If an open mouth opens options, Proverbs 18:21 says, The power of life and death is in my tongue. I want to give you about 10 to 15 seconds to speak some things over your life. Come on, take a moment. Speak some things over your kids' life. Speak some things over your husband, your wife, over your career. Come on, take a moment. Because whatever you speak in the atmosphere will manifest in your life. I'll give you another 5 seconds. Speak some things over your life. Let's look at the text. Thank you, Jesus. That's what the lepers did. They acted on what they spoke. They were not vocal only, but they were active concerning their faith. God was moving not where they were, but where they were going. He's already made the way.
But they had to get up and start going. Remember we talked about this, that they got up at twilight, and it was at twilight that they noticed that God had already worked out what they were praying and what they were concerned about. So here's your principle. Principle number one, write it down. You're going to open up extreme abundance when you don't settle and die. You're going to open up extreme abundance when you don't settle and die. What do you mean, Pastor Ben? In verse number 8, they were looking for food. But when they got there, they found food, they found clothes, they found jewelry and other things. Think about that. In verse number 8, they only went looking for food. But when they got there, they found an abundance of food, an abundance of jewelry, an abundance of clothes, an abundance of other things. Why? Because God has a way, if you don't settle, of allowing you to walk in extreme abundance. Verse number 10 says, they found transportation, they found horses, chariots, jewelry, and then they found what they weren't even looking for. You know, there's some people that bump into more blessings than other people prepare and plan for. You bump into stuff on accident because of your faith and your commitment to God. Even during crisis, even during seasons when you can't trace Him, you trust Him. And you're opening up doors of abundance. Here it is. God will always bless us in a way that's suitable, sufficient, and supernatural. Come on, write that down. That's principle number two. God will always bless us in a way that is suitable, sufficient, and supernatural. To think about this, He blessed them so good that it took them a couple of days to grab everything. Let me ask you a question. Can you handle a blessing like that? When you've got to come to the point to where you realize I'm not out of options. Even if the world says I can't have it, just because they say I can't doesn't mean God won't give it to me. Just because I'm not approved by your bank doesn't mean this bank won't approve me. God help me. Just because you won't give me the promotion doesn't mean they won't give me the promotion. Listen to this. You are never out of options. God always leaves you with some options. So in verse number 6, the king doesn't know anything about this. There were no armies coming after them. And it was just the wind that they heard when they got up and left. Now here's where the text get real interesting. Because before you can walk into the greatness, we must experience the greatness of God. I want to say that to somebody. Before you can walk in greatness, you must experience the greatness of God. Pastor Ren, make sense of that. Before you can walk in supernatural favor and supernatural grace, you must experience the greatness of God. Can I give it to you this way? Whenever we trust God, principle number 3, write it down. Whenever we trust God, we open the door to abandon abundance. Oh my goodness, I feel like shouting. Whenever we trust God, we open the door to abandon abundance. What is abandon abundance? Things that other people left. Things that other people didn't appreciate. See, somebody is messing over a good job right now that God is going to set up for you to get because you're going to appreciate it. So somebody, because they don't belong to God, is messing over an inheritance, but God is going to set it up so that you can get it because you'll appreciate it. You're going to experience abandoned abundance, things that people took for granted because you trust God, you're faithful, you're a good steward. God is going to allow you to walk into those things with no sweat, no pressure. Oh, I like to say it this way, a sweatless victory. I just showed up and things, the furniture was already in the house. I just applied for the job. And they gave me the job, the corner office, and the bonus. Can I tell you, abandoned abundance is waiting on you. Abandoned abundance. Abandoning abundance. Ah. So here it is. Here it is. Here it is. Write this down. If you're going to be great, you have to learn how to manage blessings. Come on, it's going to be on the screen for you. If you're going to be great, you got to learn how to manage abundance. Look at verse number, manage blessings. Look at verse number 9. God wants you to tell others about the blessing. Let me say this, that there's a difference in bragging and testifying. See, oftentimes we can get this thing called false humility. I don't want people to know that I got all of this. Why not? God blessed you. But I don't want people to know I can go to this vacation and I don't have to worry about how am I going to pay the rent, how am I going to pay the light bill. Why not? If they trust the same God you trust, they can experience the same type of overflow. Don't you minimize what God is doing in your life to make somebody else feel comfortable. You might need to change your circle of influence, change your circle of people. Because you need to be around people that when you tell a man, I went to Costa Rica, chartered a plane from there, went to this spot, that they're saying, really? Man, show me some pictures. Give me the number to that travel agent. I'm thinking about taking the same thing. You don't need to tell somebody and then they hate on your blessing. How were you able to go there? Who did you brown nose? Who you sleeping with on the job? The devil is a lie. Sometimes you've got to understand, I cannot hide my blessing, but God gave me this house so that I can let somebody else know. That if you do this, if you practice these principles, the same God that blessed me will bless you. The same God that gave me the car will give you one. The same God that blessed me, blessed my finances, will bless yours. I want to tell somebody, don't hide it anymore. Woo. God can bless you so good, you can hide the house, it'll show up in what you drive. You can hide the car, it'll show up in your bank account. It doesn't matter. You can hide your clothes, it'll show up in your voice, it'll show up in your look. People can see when the favor of God is on you. Stop hiding it to make them feel comfortable. Got to tell them, if you want what I have, you've got to be able to endure what I endure. We listen at this. They know other people are suffering, but sometimes God is testing us with it. Can you be blessed and manage it? Here's what I mean by that. Can you be a good steward and don't get the big head? In other words, I say like this, don't get so high on your own supply. It wasn't me that blessed me. God blessed me so that I can bless somebody else. This is where these lepers were. The Bible said, they said, if we keep this to ourselves, some punishment is going to come upon us. Let's go tell the king's house. Now, this is interesting because if you're going to be great, you've got to understand and know how to bless somebody. Listen at this, that don't like you and possibly somebody you don't even like. Y'all missed it. It's the king that put them out the city. Why am I going to bless the city? Why am I going to bless the king? He the one kicked me out. The true testament of your faith, your commitment to God, and the true testament of who you are is, can you handle blessing somebody that caused you pain? Ooh, can you wish your baby daddy's marriage success when he ain't paid child support for you, to you, but he taking care of three other kids that aren't his? Oh my goodness. Can you wish them a prosperous marriage? I didn't say be a fool. I didn't say not take him to court now. But can you wish them success? Can you pray that the co-worker you prayed for, you told them about the job you want, that undermined you so they can get the promotion? Can you pray that God give them long life, that God make their name great? Can you pray for somebody that got the car you wanted, you were turned down, but they got it? Can you really genuinely be happy for somebody else? Oh my goodness. What are you saying, Pastor Ren? Remember now, these are the same lepers that were kicked out because the king put them out. But they understood this. If we're going to be great, if we are going to be blessed, we are too blessed not to bless somebody else. Can I give you your kingdom shout? And it's a kingdom thought. I want you to keep this in your mind. Here it is. When you are blessed like you are blessed, you can't afford to harbor bitterness in your heart. Pastor Ren, make sense of that. Here it is. And I want you to write it down. It's going to be on the screen for you. Please write this down. Please screenshot it or take a note. But I need you to get this one right here. I'm too blessed and I'm too busy getting ahead to waste time getting even. I'm going to say it again. I'm too blessed and I'm too busy getting ahead to waste time getting even. All I'm trying to tell you is when God blesses you, when your heart is in the right place, you'll bless your enemies. You'll bless those that hurt you. You will bless those that didn't want to see you get it because you've got a good heart. And for that, God will honor your sacrifices. I love you. I want you to know you're not out of options. The first option you have is to bless those that hurt you. The first option you have is to pray for those that despitefully misuse you. The first option you have is to love your enemies. And when you understand that the bigger I am, the more blessed I am, the more people I can help, even the ones that didn't want to see me get it, I believe you're living a blessed life. And that's when God will honor that. I love you. We want to pray with you. Father, thank you for those that are watching. It is my prayer that my brother, my sister understand that they're not out of options, but you have something greater in store for them. God, help my sister, help my brother to realize when they get blessed that you didn't bless them so they can just be a show off, but you blessed them so they could bless somebody else. Don't allow bitterness to set in our heart. Don't allow envy to set in our heart. But God, give us a spirit of gratitude and a spirit of humility, wanting to see other people blessed despite what they said about us. It's in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name, I pray. Amen. Listen, if this message has been a blessing to you, if Kingdom Builders have impacted your life at any point during this year, during this month, I want you to consider sowing the seed into the ministry. The ways to give are there. I believe in the law of reciprocity, that whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. But I also believe this, that when you've been blessed by a particular thing, when you've been blessed by a ministry, when you've been blessed by someone, we have to give toward that to support it. Because anything we don't give to, it dies. Listen to this. When I feed my dog, it's because he gives me something. When I put gas in my car, it's because it gives me something. Well, likewise, when it comes to the kingdom of God, all of us, particularly if you're part of a local church, you should always tithe there, because that church feeds you and you want to reciprocate that back with those tangible things. And I want to encourage you to let you know you're not out of options. But Pastor Ren, what am I going to do about this? You're not out of options. Just pray. Ask God to give you some creative ideas. God, give me vision. Help me to understand my purpose. And even when it comes to my finances, God, what should I do? Give me a strategy to get out of debt. Give me a strategy to overcome what I'm dealing with. And I believe this. You sow your way out. I'm a firm believer that when you give God something to work with, and you set yourself up for a residual harvest. The information is on the screen if you would like to give through Cash App, Givelify, or text to give. Stay tuned. Somebody's coming in just a moment to share with you our first care, our health care, and first responder recipient for this particular week. I'm excited about it. It's an opportunity that we get to give to somebody. $25 gas card and lunch on KBB. I take joy in being able to bless somebody else. And I thank you for the seeds that you sow to all of our Kingdom Covenant partners. Get your seed together. Let's go ahead and sow now. I'm grateful to God for you. Thank God for your time. Let's keep building the kingdom, one person at a time. Let's build.
Hello, everyone. I'm Minister Stephanie, and I would like to announce this week's healthcare professional and first responder recipient, and it goes to Danita Duff. She is employed with UAB Hospital. Congratulations, Ms. Duff.
Wait. Think I want to hear some horns.
I never knew. with it, you gotta get, come on. Fifth one, fourth one. Come on, sing.